This is Chris Lutz interviewing Frank Carter on August 22nd, 1995 in Atlanta, Georgia. We'll get started. Why don't you tell us first your name and where and when you were born, and then you follow up.
All right. I'm Frank J. Carter, born 1903, October the 23rd, in Tampa, Florida.
I'm Howard Ward. I was born in Harlan, Kentucky, February the 12th, 1924.
Right. Two of my favorite places. A vacation in Tampa, and I was up in Harlan County to support the miners at one point.
Right. Yeah, I was born up there. All the rest of my family was born in Georgia. I was the last one of eight kids. I was born in Kentucky. But my father, he couldn't make a living on the railroad, I mean on the farm, so he moved to Kentucky and went to work there on the railroad.
Well, that actually answers my first question. Let me ask, and what did your mom do?
She's dead.
No, I mean, what did she do?
What did she do? Yeah. She was just a housewife on the farm. Mm-hmm. She never worked in her life. Other than just kept the house. Eight kids keep you busy. You
know, yeah, that's work.
Back in those days, yeah.
And Mr. Carter, what did your mom and dad do?
Well, my mother was a housewife. My father was a salesman in the advertising field.
Okay. And did you grow up in Tampa?
No, we returned to Atlanta, Georgia in 1906. Okay. And his work down there, he was sent in by a company to work in Florida for several years, and then he returned to Atlanta to continue on in the same advertising field that he was with, which eventually became a firm by the name of Brown and Bigelow. When he went to work for it, it was Brown and Company.
And what schools did you go to here?
I went to grammar school. We lived in the area that this printing firm is located, as did most people. Atlanta was only a small area at that time. But I went to grammar school, William Street Grammar School, later on to other grammar schools, grammar school being the extent of my education. I left early, went to work in the printing business, first in a small private plant. Then I went to a commercial printer as an apprentice in the composing room, setting type.
Let me ask just one question and then I want to get you on school. How old were you when you first became an apprentice?
15.
Mr. Ford, did you go to school and grow up in Kentucky?
Yeah, I went to grammar school in Louisville, Kentucky, L-O-I-L. And my father died and I went to live with my brother in Lynch, Kentucky. Went to high school in Lynch, Kentucky.
Okay, and when did you get into the printing field?
I come to Georgia in 1941. I was in Louisville, Kentucky on the way to Georgia in 1941 on D-Day. I come to Georgia then. And, of course, I got a greeting from Uncle Sam, sent me in to the Army. Uh-huh. I was working at a tablet factory, right manufacturing, manufacturing school supplies. By the time I got to Georgia, I went in the Army. I went in the Army and come out. I met my wife where I was working before I went in. She told me I had to get my job making more money than I was making then. So I said, well, I looked around and thought that. I said, well, the printing business would be a good job. So I went out on to the Rulers Press and tried to get a job, but didn't need anybody. And went over to Dittler Brothers. They was fixing to put on a night shift. I started working over there in 1946, I guess it was.
And did you start as an apprentice?
I worked up as an apprentice for 6 years. Stayed over there 6 years. And I didn't like it. It was too big a place. I didn't like a big place. I left, went on vacation, told the president of the union I wanted to change jobs when I got back off vacation. And when I got back, he told me, said, I got your job. I told him to go and see Frank Carter, Superior Printing Company.
Ah.
So I last night. I went back in that morning, come over that Monday afternoon, saw the foreman over here, and he said, yeah, you can have the job if you want it. So I went back to get different brothers my notice. And the next Monday, I come to work for Superior. That was 1952 or 3, which was it, right?
We'll say 1952.
52, I think it was.
Yeah. And it still continues on. He moved from the back end to the front end. I moved from back end early in life on my original job. I was transferred from the mechanical department to the office department. I left that firm in early 1923 to go with Williams Printing Company here in Atlanta, where I was involved with everything that went on. It also, at that time, was a very small firm. And later on in life, the Williams Printing Company owned a small business called Superior Letter Service. After several changes in management, Mr. Williams sent me to Superior Letter Service to see what I could do with it on the basis that he sent it to me. And that occurred shortly after selling the business to myself and lady bookkeeper by the name of Julia Akins, who later on in life became Miss Frank Carter.
I see.
That
it's
was
very handy marrying the bookkeeper.
I used to tell that story and it amused her. The many people that was about 58 years ago that that occurred.
Okay, well, we've got you both at Superior now.
Yeah.
What was your first impression of each other?
Well, we got along fine. We've been friends all the way through. We attended some of the labor meetings. I was interested in the labor movement when Howard came with us, and he became interested in it, I think, after he came to Superior and what have you. And we traveled the same road. In the meantime, following World War II and the price and wage freeze, Superior Printing Company signed the first contract in this country with an increase of 15% in wages, which my next step in connection with work for labor was taking part in the health and welfare insurance plan, which was put together and established in the 50s.
Okay, wait a minute. Let me go back to the end of the freeze.
Let
me go back to the end of that freeze, though.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How did the other businessmen in the community react to that? Did you catch flack for it?
I was a loner.
Wow.
Yeah, I was a loner. There was a little reaction from one of the local government officials, since it was a test case. He asked me if I knew what I was doing, and I said yes. He says, well, I'm going to take this to Washington and see. So he got on the train. There wasn't too many planes around at that time. Took it to Washington. It was approved, and there was no problem. I was never reprimanded by anybody. In the meantime, the local printers, the local union printers, did favor it because prices were up. The men had not had an increase in some time, and they were entitled to one. In addition to that, manpower was short during the war years, and what have you, so on. But it was a good move.
And it must have made you very surprised when you came here and found out you had a pro-union company.
Well, I've always been in favor of union. You know, coal miners, John L. Lewin, I mean, the organized coal miners in Kentucky, that was part of the time I was growing up up there. And that's the first thing I looked for when I coming right out and went to go to work after I got out of the Army, the union. I worked a year under permit, then I come into the union as an assistant. I worked a year and a half as an assistant, and then they put me on apprentice training program. I stayed on it till I got the journalism card after 4 years. It took 4 years to complete the journalism course.
What is working under permit?
They give you a year's trial to see whether you're going to make a good number, whether you're going to pan out, or what you're going to do, rather than take you into the local union and start with, because working under a permit. It costs you $1.50 a month for dues to be under a permit while you're working.
Okay. Kind of a trial membership, maybe? Like a trial
membership? Yeah, that's about what it is. You can see whether you don't say it goes cut the mustard or not. Whether you're going to make the grade, that'd be a better way to put it.
So now you came here in the 50s, and did you work together on the health benefits?
Well, it was negotiated. The benefits were negotiated through the union contract.
Okay.
We was the first company that negotiated the health and welfare. The unit helped negotiate. Health and welfare was citywide. All the employers that were under contract came into the health and welfare fund at that time. Negotiating on the contract.
Wow. Looking back at that period, would you say that that was a great achievement? It sounds like a pretty staggering.
It was making history at that time, part of history. Mm-hmm. And the printing industry was the second industry in Atlanta at that time to go into the health and welfare insurance. The first one known to me was the Plumbers Union. They were the first to bring it to Atlanta. And then, actually, I gathered information from the Plumbers Union. Went to our local printers club who worked it out. And the printers in general, the employing printers, did want to establish it.
The hardest trouble we had on our side was selling it to the membership.
Why?
They didn't want to give up the money to pay to buy insurance with. When it went into effect, instead of taking a 6.5 cent an hour raise, we took that 6.5 cents an hour and bought insurance with it to the membership. And now the members are covered, and we're paying what, $438 a month. Now that's how much it's went up.
Yeah. And so you caught flack for members at that time. Were you a union officer at that time?
I've been a union officer ever since the second year I got in the trade. I come out and started out. I was an assistant on the executive board.
What on earth made you get into that thankless job?
Well, they elected me to it. Mm-hmm. And I helped that job. The recording secretary resigned. When he resigned, they elected me recording secretary at a local, and I've been recording secretary since.
So you caught flack from the members, and you caught flack from the business community.
Right.
Yeah.
Lucky you were friends with each other.
I can make a statement about the health and welfare insurance in connection with the union. The president of the Pressman's Union at that time did not want the insurance. He did not work for it. He worked against it. But in the course of time, he was the first one to draw benefits from the insurance plan. Mm-hmm. You remember his name?
Alvin Wood.
Alvin Woods.
Worked at River Sprint Company.
Yeah.
Telephone printer, one of printed telephone books.
Oh, is that right? My husband is in charge of the typesetting for Peachtree City, both of them.
Peachtree City.
And some other little small towns over there. Now, what was it like to work here during the 1950s?
Wonderful. Always wonderful. You won't find a better man anywhere to work for than Mr. Carter is. He treats everybody fair and square. He gives them the best equipment to work with, the best benefits, and everything else that you got to go.
You left Harlan County and came to heaven. So why did I do this sooner?
He is. He's straight and square and treats all his employees fairly. He gives them all a good job, good benefits. And you can tell that, but most of them that's here has been here at least 15 years, 20 years, 25 years. And you keep people working for you that long, but there's bound to be something good about it.
Why is that? Why are you so different from so many other employers?
Well, I first worked in the printing industry, and then I became an employer, and I decided to change a few things and do it my way, so to speak. That's what it amounted to. Insofar as small items here and there, we were the first one to do it.
Well, you must have been concerned then as a young man about the health situation.
That's correct.
What else bothered you about your own situation when you were a printer? What else did you want to change?
Well, look, later on in 68, the pension was an important item. Mm-hmm. The two of us brought it to Atlanta.
Tell me about the pension.
About what?
Tell me about the pension. Tell me about what you did.
The pension was started on the West Coast. The local and one of the councils out there started out what they call a West Coast pension plan. Mm-hmm. And before that, we had a plan of the international that was originally started was back when you had a lot of people with TB. They had a pressman home up in Tennessee. And they built a sanatorium up there to treat the TB patients with. And after they got TB under control, you had no more use for it. Then they took the money that they put in with the TB patients, they'd give 25 cents a week each member to treat patients up there, and it didn't cost them anything. Well, they took that 25 cents and started what they called a pension plan. And naturally, as it grew, well, the pension run out of money. With 25 cents a week, it wasn't enough for the members that was retiring that, so they come up with a West Coast plan. And we went to them. I was at the International Union when they voted to do away with the pension plan at Pressman's Home, at the International Convention. And that way, the money that was in there, they kept paying it out, they went broke, no more money went into it. So when they got the West Coast plan, it took us, what, about 3-4 years to set up the membership, didn't it, Mr. Frank?
Yes, and it also was what was known as an industrial plan and listed with the IRS, which made it a very satisfactory plan.
Why is that?
Well, it had the necessary supervision to see that the money was properly handled and held in reserve for the purpose it was intended to pay pensions, mm-hmm. and not to be used otherwise.
That's all the money can be used for is pensions for the membership.
It's key now, too,
like the other pension plan. A lot of you see these companies, like airlines, they got a pension plan. Eastern Airline, they had a pension plan, but they come find out after they went out of business, where's the pension plan money? But this one was set up strictly for pension plan. And it's paying good benefits now. The numbers back here, we started out 1 unit, $2.50 a unit. And they're up now, we're paying $6 a month for each unit. I mean, 6 units a month, which is $10 a unit. We get $66 a month for every year they work here on a pension plan. And some of them back there now have got, I say, about between $900 and $1,000 worth of pension built up now. they're still young boys. Still got another 10, 12, 15 years to work. Some of them draw a darn good pension for some of them. And the money's there, you don't have to worry about it. That's all they can do with it. And so far, they've just about had enough income until 87, I guess, they had enough income that the interest in the income off the pension plan was paying the pensioners' pensions. So when the interest rate went down a little bit, they're having now to take a little of the principal out. But still, they get the money still coming in, still money investing.
That's quite remarkable, actually. That's another.
The thing is, if you die before you retire, your wife gets all the money that's been paid into the pension plan on your half of the settlement, which is pretty darn good.
Well, I'd be a little nervous around my wife.
You got an option. You can take a lesser amount, and if you die, your wife gets a certain amount of benefits as long as she lives. It's really a plan that anybody would be proud of.
Sounds like an excellent plan.
Yeah, it's one of the as good a one that I've come across in all the labor organizations in. It's really a good plan.
Let me take you back to the 50s. What kind of printing work was Superior doing in the 1950s?
We were doing the same type of work as we're doing now, more or less public relations type of printing, as well as some other types of hotel work, benefit booklets for the industry. Things of that kind. The technology, of course, is entirely different today than it was then. When I went into the printing business to work in the typesetting department, most type was set by hand. One letter, one figure, one character at a time in a little device called a stick. The linotype was beginning to enter the industry, mainly in the newspapers, and was becoming available to the commercial printers. But it was not favorably looked upon by the workers. They felt that the linotype was taking the work away from them, actually taking the bread off their table. But it did go on and change to the type of technology we have today, which means there is no type at all. It's an electronic procedure that forms the type. How important can you add to technology?
You're the computer generation.
To that technology, well, I can say the time I come to work for Superior Print Company, served an apprenticeship before I come, and since then I've served either five or six more. Because I started out on the letter press. I went from the letter press to offset. Offset to the camera department, I'm the camera. Went to the plate making department, done the stripping, plate making, and camera. Run the press, offset. Went in the offset business. So I've changed from letter press to offset, camera, to stripping, to plate making. Over the period of time, it's just been a constant change.
Have you entered the computer generation yet?
Well, we're in that up to our ears right now. We're just switching over to the Macintosh now, going into it, and the technology has changed as fast. There's no way you can keep up with it. You buy it today and it's outmoded tomorrow.
That's right. Of all those different apprenticeships that you served, all the different jobs that you were doing, what was the most difficult and what was the easiest?
I guess the camera work was probably the easiest, but all you do is open the camera and lay the copy down on it. Push a button and stick the film in a developing machine, and it comes out the other end. That's the easiest one.
What was the most difficult? Or the most distasteful, I should probably say.
Running the press, I guess.
Running the press, huh?
But it's a lot of fun.
Looking back, what was the best part of your job?
The best part of it was wanting to come to work each morning and early, because you knew that there'd be an assortment of various things to do, that you'd be busy all day, and your work would change from customer to customer, and what have you. I won't say a word about the apprenticeship.
Okay.
In the early 50s, through the local Promise Club that I was a member, and given various jobs, I was brought into the Southern States Apprenticeship Committee, which was the Western and Eastern states of the South. They held a yearly meeting in which various apprentices were awarded a prize. There was a trip to another town. When they came to Atlanta, I was given the main job of doing all of the legwork necessary to bring it home. Also, it turned out to be quite a gathering of people. They had to use the city auditorium in order to hold the attendance and have the banquet, which was the main function of the week's time. At that time, I was co-chairman of the apprenticeship committee of the Atlanta Typographical Union, number 48. I served on that for 20 years. After 20 years in the early 70s, I transferred to the Printing Pressman's Apprenticeship Committee and served as co-chairman for 2 years on it. Apprenticeship in Atlanta began to die out and is almost gone at this time in life, and actually they're most needed. Howard Ward is a member of the one existing plan in the printing business in Atlanta.
We're the only local that still has an apprentice program working. I'm chairman of it. Been chairman of it for 30 years, I guess.
How does the apprentice program work?
You got on-the-job training. It's a 4-year course, and then the international furnishes you a correspondence course. Answer them. Take the correspondence course and get on-the-job training at the same time. And it takes a 4-year course or 2-year. Apprentices, he comes up, he gets raised every 6 months over his 4 years. In fact, I went to the Labor Temple this morning and awarded 3 journeyman certificates. Had 3 coming out of the Ruler's Press over there. They had 3 coming out today, so I went over there and presented them with the certificates this morning before I came over here.
Well, congratulations to them.
Yeah.
I've served on a lot of committees and that in the trade. I've been on the apprenticeship committee. I've been the delegate of the AFL-CIO and Atlanta Federation of Trade. I attend all their meetings and done a lot of organizing during my time. Spent a lot of time. I look at it. A lot of people's got different hobbies. A lot of people do this. A lot of people work for churches. A lot of them work for this, that, and the other. My union is my hobby. It's always been my hobby. I give my time to the union, which where a lot of people give it to church or something else. But my time has always been the union.
When you served as a delegate to the AFL-CIO, It just occurred to me that when the AFL-CIO got together, you were a union man. What did you think about the merger?
That's the best thing that ever happened.
Yeah. Why do you say that?
Well, they was combined instead of pulling apart this way. Uh-huh. You know, you put two horses together and give them a stick of corn in here. You put them this way and you pull that way, and either one of them, you get your head with mine, my head with this one. We eat this now, then we come over here and eat that one. That way, that's what happened. Instead of pulling this way, they both got together and accomplished the same thing. Instead of one trying to take away from the other one and pull it apart.
Mm-hmm. And Mr. Carter, while we're on the 50s too, there's something else that came up nationally, which was the Taft-Hartley Act. You remember Taft-Hartley too.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
What was your opinion of Taft-Hartley when it came through?
Yeah. Okay.
It stinks. I think that's enough said about Taft-Hartley law. It all stinks. Right. And the one that stinks worse than that's the right to work law. Georgia State, right to work law. That's the worst one. Yeah. And that's done more to hurt the people of the state of Georgia than anything that I know of that's been happening to the working people.
On to something more pleasant. What was it like living in Atlanta in the 1950s, living and working in Atlanta in the 1950s? What do you remember from the 50s?
Well, it was an entirely different ballgame altogether. The city was smaller. I best remember Atlanta and working in the 20s when it was a very small town compared to now. You knew people, you knew a lot of people in the city, which you can't say you do today when the city is so large. The downtown area was the main area for the business back in the early period of the time. At that time, we had three newspapers in Atlanta, which spoke well of it. We have one today, two names for one newspaper. The downtown area was here because of the drinking water. The springs in the city, they absolutely covered the downtown area. And when the people first moved in to Atlanta, that was many, many years ago, they found that animals had trails leading to these various springs. That's where they got their water, that's where the people. And that's why it was first inhabited in this area. But when I went to work, many of the large buildings in the city, if you had business in the basement, quite often you'd see those springs bubbling up right in the basement. The Atlanta Journal newspaper, in my first visit to it, was in the basement where there was a department of the newspaper. At one side of the big room, there's just a series of small springs that were bubbling. Later on in life, they learned how to cap those. But originally, they did not. But the smaller the city, the more people you seemed to know. You knew where everybody was located and that kind of thing. And that's all changed. It's changed. But people moving out in the period when they started moving out, they moved in every direction, and then the expressways came, and that further divided things up into certain channels as against what it had been. So
you had a city back in the 40s, and that might. You could say the city was from Riches to Davison's, and that was the main part of the city of Atlanta. That's how big it was back then, back in the 30s. 30s and 40s.
What were you doing in the 1950s?
1950s?
Yeah. Were you organizing, and what were you doing for entertainment?
Fifties. That's when you came to Superior.
Yeah, that's when I came to Superior. That's when I got out of the Army in 45. Okay. And I got married in September 46. I came to Superior. Went in the print business, I guess, in June of 46. When I first went in there. So I was just out of the Army and serving the apprenticeship in the 50s. Okay. Now, getting started, fixing to get married.
Where did you go on dates with your fiancé?
Downtown in the movie.
Yeah.
That's about the only place it was then.
No.
It wasn't this nightlife, you know. And back then, at 8:30, 9 o'clock at night, the city was deserted. Nobody was on the streets after that. They always called it roller streets up at 8 o'clock at night back then. There wasn't nothing going on. It wasn't always nightlife then like it is now.
Mm-hmm. Did you all like it better then?
Much so.
Did you like it better then?
Atlanta? I've always liked it. I take it as it is, as it happens. Mm-hmm. Going back to the period of World War II, when the large aircraft factory opened up near Atlanta, Bell Aircraft, it became a 24-hour-a-day city. They worked thousands of people, and then they worked three shifts. And what in the downtown section was alive at any time during the 24-hour period. And of course, it has changed. There's very little traffic through the metropolitan area at night now. At one time, it had. By the time of 6 o'clock in the evening, there was absolutely no traffic. And the Marriott chain came in here and built a hotel at the corner of Portland and Ellis Street. And they opened up some fine eating rooms, banquets, and that sort of thing. And it started bringing the city back to life in the downtown area.
And you would just assume that it had been like comatose.
I just assumed it stayed by like that. I like to ride the old streetcar and get your token $2.15 and that, and go to the movie for 30 cents and have a whole date with your wife or your fiance or whatever for 50 or 75 cents, and that was
not
it.
Not bad, yeah. When they say I'm a cheap date, then they really meant it.
But. I mean, it had to be cheap because you wasn't making no money.
Well, coming up to the 60s, things really started changing in Atlanta around civil rights, too, because you had King here.
Yeah.
Did that affect Superior at all, civil rights movement?
I wouldn't say it did. Would you, Mr. Frank?
No, I don't know. It brought us more business from various and sundry black organizations that came into being. Didn't we still print for?
Oh, like who?
Like
who?
Well, the Urban League, for one. They've been a customer here for years and years. But various and sundry organizations that had need for printing, what have you. Some of the unions have a large black membership. And the only point here is that it's brought in customers, mm-hmm. many of whom we still serve.
And now I'm going to ask a tough one in terms of the late 60s. How about the women's movement? Did you get any women coming here and saying, can I be a printer too?
I didn't need
to. I was wondering how the women's movement might have affected Superior, and
yeah.
Women want to be printers.
Yeah, years ago, going back to the 50s, there was a women's organization that we printed foil. It was a national note. I couldn't tell you the name now, but it was the basic woman's organization of the country through their local chapter.
National Organization of Women, maybe?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. NOW?
I can't recall the name of it. I seldom read about it anymore, but they were, I guess the main thing they had in mind, in addition to the meetings and the various and sundry items of that kind, was the political arena. That's when they were kind of active in politics and what have you. We print for one ladies' organization now, Executive Women Incorporated, that they're more or less just a, I guess you'd call it a fraternal group. They don't preach politics or what have you. They just go about the business of living and having fun and put on a couple of parties a year for their sponsors, that is, the employers and so on.
Yeah, the women seem to take more to the binary work than they do the press work or the composure work. They take more to the binary. It's easier work. They're better at it than the men. The light gathering work and folding and that type of stuff. In my experience, there's never been too many women in the press room. There's been a few, but not too many. They never took to it too manual labor, I guess, for them.
Is it heavy work, or was it, I should say, back in the late 60s?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Press work is heavy any time. Yeah. You go loading and unloading presses and this, that, and all that. You get a 16 sheet of paper, 30 by 60 or something like that, and have this stack up like that, and load the feeders. Now, it's manual work.
Yeah. Okay. That probably explains it.
Yeah.
Tell me, if you could look back at, say, the 60s and the 50s, what would you relive? What would you say, I want to do that again?
I never really looked on it in that manner. I do end it each day with the thought of getting something out of it and putting something into it and what have you. And if there is any unfinished business from yesterday, I attend to that as quickly as possible. Mm-hmm. But after a good night's rest and a good morning's breakfast, the desire to get out and get with it and see what's going on and take part in it as it is. I find very few things that I do not find a good point in connection with it, no matter how serious or how bad. If you look hard enough, there's a good point there somewhere. Maybe it's educational, but it's there.
Well, that's the optimist. I'm a pessimist. Would you pick? Can you pick out something from the, say, 50s or 60s that you would say, I'll do that one more time?
Not necessarily. I'm glad I went through them, but it was an experience getting through them after the war and that. Everything mm-hmm. boomed out and everybody got going and this, that, and the other. But looking back, I wouldn't trade none of it in the past of what I'm doing now and what I've got now. Mm-hmm. And I think the whole generation, all the way around, are better off now than they were back then. So it's just one of the things that's come about over a period of time has changed things in that. But I've been happy all through my life. I've enjoyed every minute of it. I wouldn't trade it for nothing. But I wouldn't want to go through it again.
You lived it right the first time.
that could be. It's been experience and been a lot of enjoyment getting through it. A lot of people, a lot of customers, and a
Who stands out? I'll ask you both this question too. Who stands out in your mind as a memorable person? Not necessarily a famous, but just a memorable person of the past year. So would you say that was a person I'm glad I knew?
How far back can you go?
As far as you want.
Yeah, well, when I first entered the printing business as an apprentice, the Atlanta Printing Pressman Assistance Union had a president by the name of Sid Teller, T-I-L-L-E-R. He worked for the Ruralist Press at that time. Later on, he was connected with politics and went on to become, well, one of the well-known people in the city. But in connection with my work, and I was there as an apprentice, every time he came to the printing company, he also visited with me a few minutes and took up time and pointed out a few things along the way. I've never forgotten it because of my position and my age and his way of looking after things. Incidentally, probably to a lot of people in that era was the best president that they ever had, all the way through. He went on to some job with the city of Atlanta, connection with public housing, wasn't it, Howard?
I think he was a tax assessor, wasn't he?
What?
Wasn't he something to do with the tax assessing or tax appraisals or something?
Well, it was political and what have you.
How about you for a memorable person?
About the one man I've admired most and the one that I think done as good as any of them was Tom Donahue. Major Perry. Tom Donahue would come after Major Perry. Major Perry was the one that was responsible for the Pressman's Union, really.
It's Major Perry?
Mm-hmm.
Major Perry or Senator Perry. Call him by either one, but you certainly better give him one of his two titles.
He was the one that founded Pressman's Home in Tennessee and built the headquarters up there with the technical school. We had a big four-story technical school up there to teach the training and training to the Pressman and that. And he was quite a man to do the job that he done and the way he done it and what he done. Anybody would have to admire.
As well as the TB hospital that was there at Pressman's Home in Tennessee.
Yeah, you can think it. I went up there and paid him a visit a couple of times. Just looked the place over and see what it was, man. It was quite a place up there. It had a lot of acreage.
Tell me about it. What did they teach there?
All phases of printing. They had a hotel up there. The students went up there and lived up there. Go to school. I was born.
Nice.
And they raised all the food up. They had cattle, and farms, and everything up there.
How did they support themselves? I mean, aside from raising their own food, did dues go to pay for it?
Yeah.
Okay.
It cost you to go.
Oh, okay.
To go to school up there, yeah. Mm-hmm. It was very cheap, though. Probably a dollar a day for a place to live. A couple of meals didn't cost that much. But you go up there and it didn't cost really compared to what it would cost today.
Gentlemen, will you explain the printing process to me, please? Could you please do this for me? Could you please explain the process of printing for the future? Here comes the customer and says, I've got a job. What happens then?
All right. Somebody takes the order. Nothing happens till the order is taken.
Okay.
And After taking the part, I'm going through the routine of finding out the desires of the customer. It sometimes goes to a layout person or an artist, if you will, to make it into a job. Then the type and artwork is put into proof form and submitted to the customer for approval. Quite often there are changes made, but eventually it's improved and it goes to the plate department where the negatives and plates are made. Going then to the press room where it's to be printed. In the meantime, the paper the customer has ordered is there in the press room and it's printed. Then from the press room, it goes to the binder department, which is really the finishing department, folding, doing whatever is necessary to complete the job and wrap it up and deliver it.
Do you want to throw some more in there?
He's pretty well covered.
Pretty well covered. Mm-hmm. We were talking before we came back in the room about how you still have a union card. How you still have a union card.
Yeah, it's a retired union card, but I have one. I'm a member of the Bookbinders Union, number 96B. Uh-huh. It's got some years on it. Originally, I could have gotten a card in any one of the unions, of course, I could dabble with any of the work in the shop. I could take an order, and I could set it up, and I could print it, and I could bind it. What it might also could deliver it and collect for it.
Mm-hmm. But of course you have to pay all those different union dues, so yeah. Just one was good.
Early on I got into front end work. Mm-hmm. Got into that place I started as an apprentice. It didn't take me long to graduate to the office. And at the age of 18 I was supervising and running a small printing firm, about 12 people, for an estate. And I left there in early 1923 and went to work for Williams Printing Company, where I was still a front end man, handling sales, going out, picking up some, doing certain part of the production work in the place, supervision. I also was the grief man at Williams Printing Company. Jeez. And I've been somebody's grief man ever since, my own at the present time.
Does that mean that you give grief or take grief?
Well, I live with it. I roll with the punch. Whatever. I'm still here after all of these years. No, I've worked in the neighborhood of 75 years now.
You planning on retiring?
My wife, when she was still alive, said that she hoped that when I did go, that I'd be in a printing establishment and I'd just fall flat on my face.
It's a curse. Well, now, what's the union card, Mr. Ward, that you carry in your wallet?
I carry it in Graphic Communications.
All right.
ADM.
And
used to be just eight, but we've done the merging together. And they started the ADM. Mm-hmm. We merged with the Bookbinders and we merged with the newspaper. Not the Bookbinders, I'll take it back and merge with the newspaper. Mm-hmm. And with the photo engravers. So we can come up with three and they put it with the merged.
Well, you were talking before, you mentioned before that you had been on some organizing drives. Can you tell me about a couple? Don't want to go too far back.
No, it didn't want to do that. Biggest defeat I had was trying to organize W.R. Bean. Okay. They come up and wanted the union to really come election day in time to vote, and then they vote the union out. That's what happens in a lot of times. It used to do a lot. have some success organizing. We haven't been able to organize none in the last 10, 12, 15 years.
Why do you think that is?
It's the way the labor laws are more than anything else. I mean, if you win an election, you can't get a contract with an employer. The way the laws are, that there's something missing somewhere that there's no teeth into it to make the company sit down and negotiate in good faith. They can drag it out and drag it out, and that's so long time that everybody's lost interest in everything.
Do you agree with that? Do you think that's why it's so hard to organize now?
Well, I guess we all think differently and what have you. I don't think there's really been any time spent in recent years to speak of in the organizing work, although at the last national meeting of the AFL-CIO, they talked about putting on an organizing campaign. I'm still looking to see it happen, but no doubt it will. But I guess organizing has been with us quite a while, but in the past number of years, I won't say how many, 10, 15, maybe 20 years, there's been practically no effort to organize. Here and there, just spite it for certain reasons, which I don't know about. But there's another side of the labor that both Howard and I have been in contact with. That's a thing called the Workman's Circle Banquet of the Year, in which various labor leaders are honored and what have been. People have an opportunity to talk and to make various statements. We also are connected to the thing called the Georgia Union Labor Management, which meets for several days each year. So far it's been at Jekyll Island. Howard is just back from the last one, which was probably the 15th to 18th of August
last week.
What do you all talk about?
It's just to get together with union, labor and management to try to carve a better relationship so each one can understand the other side of it.
Nice,
it's,
and you
do
it Jekyll Island too.
Yeah, nice. But it's good informative for both sides. I mean, labor and management. It teaches them our side, and it teaches us their side. And we started out, I guess, this was the sixth one they held. We started out, I think, with probably 50, 75 people, wasn't it, Mr. Frank?
Yeah, just that. About.
Mm-hmm. And this time we had, I think, 350 delegates and about, and the guest, I think, the whole total was about 550 people.
Don't shake it, Bill Clinton.
So it's growing, see, all the time, and getting more popular now. It's put on a mediation and conciliation to the federal government. Mm-hmm. They're the ones that get it together and host it now. And it's turned out to be the most popular thing. It's come in, kind of happened to labor lately, in my opinion. It's got a lot of good information stuff about it.
Think that labor management cooperation along this sort of line is the future?
It's going to have to be. Mm-hmm. It's going to have to be. If both survive.
Would you agree, Mr. Clinton? Would you agree that union management cooperation of this sort would be the future?
It's absolutely beneficial. And without it, you're not going to have too much. That's where it is today, is people getting to know each other, have enough confidence in each other, they'll sit down, take each other's word, and proceed from there. The day of the strike is gone. It's of no benefit to anybody. Both sides lose, what have you. So it's And even in today's market, when union membership has been dropping, you still have 95 or 96% of the contracts that are settled just on a regular business basis, whatever term, with 5-year contract, 3-year contract, 1-year contract, people get together and work out their differences. And that those are people that are in the human resources department, formerly the personnel department, and they're the ones that meet in this Georgia Union Labor Management. And of course, the reason is that they work together, they have seminars, you know, and they can play together, they have a little golf, a little fishing, a little of this, that. Mm-hmm. A few groceries along the way that go along with several meals that during the 4-day period of time. It's a real nice affair.
And Georgia State's involved in it too, and Biff Hill reported, he's a master chairman.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. Yeah, he stands all of it. So
yeah, you turn up there all the time, don't we?
Yeah, he's pretty hefty guy.
Well, now, do you agree that the day of the strike is passed?
Not quite.
Not quite.
We got one that hasn't been settled yet.
Would you tell me about that, please? The strike not quite being over.
Yeah. American Signature brought it out, or supposed to, and then Fuji Bank settled, and I think Fuji Bank got a hold of it. And when they did, they come in and posted the conditions for the employees. Well, I wouldn't say the posted conditions, they fired all of them. They fired everybody in the company. And then they posted conditions for them to work under, took all the benefits away from them, and so forth, the same yard and all that. So they went back in, tried to get a contract, couldn't get one. So after they posted conditions, hired some of them back, the ones that didn't want, they didn't hire back. So they didn't like it, so they went on strike. Been on strike now for about 27, 28 months. I don't know whether it's ever going to end or not, the way it's going now. They ain't making no progress. Getting a new contract and that. It's just one of those things. It's happening in a lot of places now. Caterpillar's another big one. They've been on strike for about no time now. Can't get a contract with any baseball playoffs. They haven't got no contract yet. It's just one after the other. It's getting harder and harder. That's why I say the future of it is labor management to get together and use their heads and work out something between them. That's the future of it.
Do you feel that's what happened here at Superior? Is that, would you say that characterizes Superior?
Right. Always has. We never failed to come up with an agreement. Mr. Carter's been generous.
Put that with your file, take it with you, and look it over at some time in your life. It's pretty well kept.
Yeah, I'll make this my supplementary material. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Now, speaking of strikes and trying to work things out, was there ever a time that you wanted to take a poke at somebody? And not each other.
No, I never did get into that sort of thing. I don't try to get too mad at anybody to begin with. I'm out to make friends if possible.
Well, that was the optimist. Now we'll go to the pessimist, Mr. Ward.
I've never had any problem with Frank whatsoever.
Oh, no, I was kidding about not being him. I meant in general, was there somebody you wanted to take a poke at in the past? Memorable in a bad way.
No. Not that I know of. But, yeah, there was. One time, since I can remember. There's been the boundary union, and I wanted to poke him one night.
Well, tell me about it. Why?
He called me a bad name.
Uh-huh.
It was during the strike in 1970 when the whole city went on strike. Uh-huh. He was up in the labor temple one night, and he started off. I started to crawl over the desk after him. They had to restrain me. That's the only time that I ever, as long as I've been in the business, I wanted to get with somebody. So the word he called me, I don't think anybody would take it. But he didn't come back and apologize for it.
Well, what happened in 1970? What was going on in 1970?
The employers of all the companies were negotiating at the same time at that time. Had one contract citywide. Well, and in 1970 they couldn't reach an agreement with the union, so the whole city struck.
Superior too?
Yeah. Every south of the city.
Well, Mr. Frank, didn't you have a debate in your mind about whether to walk the picket line or not?
the picket line was at Superior for one day. Mm-hmm. Actually, I had worked out a contract with all four unions in the city. It had not been signed, and they were out here for one day on a technical point. And but at 20 minutes to four, the day of that one strike, I called up the president of the Freshman's Union and asked him how we stood. He stuttered a little bit. I said, at 4 o'clock, I'm going to start negotiations with the Amalgamated Freshman's Union. He called up 5 minutes later and said, we'd be in there at 10 o'clock in the morning. That's what actually happened. But they should not have been out for the one day. I had come to an agreement with four different men.
More strikes are going. I mean, Garbage people struck and all those at one time back then, demonstration and that. But at that 70 strike, it just ruined the city, and then since then, each individual company's been negotiating their own contract.
Does that work? That works out better with Superior, though, doesn't it? I mean, as opposed to, say, having to deal with Fuji Bank?
Yeah, I guess you might say that, but back then, you didn't have that much trouble. Up until then, there'd been, ever since it started, you'd been negotiating all the contracts at one time, all in one, and all the crafts. The pressmen and the tapos and the binder all went in with the employers, and they all sat down. When they come out, they had a contract with all the crafts.
Uh-huh. That's what you had done in 70, right?
Yeah. Yeah, the fact that telephone conversation that I just called your attention to you and the words that I said that brought him back to the job proves that I had already negotiated the contract and we were in agreement. It was just a technical point that the contract, in fact, they didn't have anything for you to sign at that time. On the Monday that they were out, that's when they got busy and drew up the contract.
Sorry, Ari. well, in 1970, was the reason that the strike had to happen or did happen, was that because other printing shops?
The reason that strike occurred was because the international unions passed word down that various things were to be done, like the wage increase was the main thing. Incidentally, it was 25%. It was a pretty hefty increase. But it was instigated by the international unions. And the locals were told to follow through. And the strike here in the city of Atlanta lasted about 6 weeks.
And do you remember it that way too, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. I'd like to get the labor management view sometimes too. Now, since we're on the city of Atlanta, you both have been around through many mayoral administrations. Mm-hmm. Alternately, what mayor was best for labor? What mayor was best for management? Or not management, best for business, I should say.
I can answer that for both sides.
Oh, okay.
Mayor Hartsfield.
Okay, William Hartsfield.
Right. He done more for this city than any man or any mayor that ever has been, ever will be, I believe. Mm-hmm. They haven't anybody come close to meeting him yet.
Mm-hmm. Incidentally, I was his printer from 1923 on, and at his death, I printed the program for his funeral. Where's Ron's?
Would Hartsfield be right up there with your
Oh, yeah, yeah. I was on the Hartsfield team all of those years. He never had anything printing and other things, too. He called me on the phone and I'd answer. He said, Hartsfield, I need you over here. I'd immediately quit what I was doing and go to City Hall. And eventually, there was no parking there, but the City Hall building was on a full block and the only occupied part, the rest of it was just grass. But I used to just pull up there. There was always a policeman on duty, and I was telling you, I said, may a couple of weeks show up here immediately. He said, go ahead. And he was a fine man. The water that you drink in Atlanta today was one of his favorite topic subjects, and he spent a lot of time on it. Lake Lanier was built because of him and the Army Corps of Engineers. Lake Altoona was likewise built. He had a message for everybody connected with water and the amount of it that the city of Atlanta was going to use. Also, while he was mayor, it was always the purest water in the nation. And you know, to get all those samples together and grade them, what have you. But since he left office, the water department has not been run as well. Has not had the attention. And we're somewhere down the line. I don't know where we stand, but from time to time on television they'll tell you about your water, talk to you about bottled water and that kind of thing. There'll never be another one that will even make a down payment on what he did for the city.
The airport's a good example of that.
Yes.
Airport is a good example. Hey, if we hadn't done that, we might have been in the international city yesterday. Mm-hmm. When he left office, he had the city working on a balanced budget. If you had the money, spend it. If you didn't, you didn't spend it. That's the education of the federal government, I would take, and the city governments now. It'd be a good idea for them to shoot for it. But he did. If you didn't have the money, you don't spend it. Yeah, man. He worked on a balanced budget every year when he was in it.
He used to be his own chauffeur, drive his own car on city business. Since that, every mayor we've had has had a big, fine Lincoln, a car of that kind, with a city policeman driving it for him, but never with him. He also spent a lot of time on the job after he got off from his office duties in the afternoon. He'd get in his car and tour the city, whatever. He was looking into just about everything that went on. Police calls, fire calls. He attended meetings just about all. A little bit ago, Howard was talking about even Major Senator Barry. When he came to Atlanta, the one and only time that he came here, sometime in the 40s, Hartsfield was mayor. He attended that meeting, that type of thing. He was just wherever the people were, wherever they met. If they had a need for him, they wanted him to speak when he did. Like in a famous movie called Dawn with the Wind was here. He met with the entertainment people, the stars, and then Clark Gable and several others. They boarded out at the Hostel Inn hotel there, the Fox Theater, right across the street. It was a big publicity affair, you know. They had a microphone. He was there to speak at that event. Well, if anything of importance was going on in Horsfield, was a great, great man. After he left the city, he was put on the board of the Ford Foundation and several other things of that type. I don't know what it was, but whatever he made as mayor, when he left the mayor's office and went on these different boards, he was earning three times what he did as mayor. And he kept his own salary down. In addition to that, he got the state legislature to pass a law that the city of Atlanta could not make any purchase unless they had the money to pay for it. Since he went out of office, that law has been rescinded by other mayors.
Such is the fate of politicians in politics. Let me ask you both. If you had a chance to stand on a stage and talk to, a 1,000 young printers, what advice would you give them about unions and about work generally? Why don't you go first, Mr. Ward? I'll embarrass you first.
Lord, that's a hard question to answer, I tell you. There's so many things involved in it, man. But to me, I think it's as good a way to make a living as there is. My advice to them is steady work, it's inside work. It's work, but it's compensation for it is good. And I take it over the outside brick basement or something like that where you're out in the world and it's cold all the time. Inside you're warm in the spring, you're cool in the summer. And it's one of the easiest considering it, but in a might say skilled crafts, it's as good a job as any that I've come across. Whether it be steam fitters or plumbers or whatever, I tell them that it's got a future to it. It's always been a man's friend. Always. That's what this country was built on, was a friendly word. It protects books and all of that, but it's a proven fact. You read papers, new technology that's coming out, it'll take away part of it. They're still always going to be the man for the family. It's got as good a future to it as anything I know of.
What would your advice to the young people be?
I'd say that the printing business is a good way to make a living. And I'd say to the young people that go into it to learn their trade and stick with it. Work hard. Don't worry about money. If you stick with it and work hard, if you're entitled to it, it's going to come to you. But well, look at it this way. It should be with us forever. Just imagine walking into a grocery store without any labels on the can and finding the string beans that you wanted without a printed label. In other words, you stop the presses and you stop time.